A very good evening to you. Welcome to the Wednesday edition of the DBS News World. My name is Timothy Polion. We commence the broadcast with news that the government of St. Lucia today signed a $115 million contract, which will see the rehabilitation of the Millennium Highway and the West Coast Road. The project is a fulfillment of the administration's promise to transform the island's road network and get it to an international standard. All this in the hope of minimizing traffic congestion and reducing the number of road fatalities. DBS's Sheffield Gillard begins our news coverage.
The $75 million Millennium Highway was commissioned on February 3, 2001, and is one of the busiest roads on the island. Constructed with easier gradients, gentler curves, and a wider road surface, it was much easier to drive, was supposed to be safer, quicker and less stressful, and was supposed to enhance the economic development of St. Lucia, Castries in particular. Just a few years after construction, what seemed to be a better alternative was proving to be anything but. The infrastructure began to collapse in certain areas, to the point where drivers linked it to riding on a roller coaster. In addition, the Millennium Highway became the scene of many collisions, several fatal.
This project, the Millennium Highway and West Coast Road upgrading project, is intended to rehabilitate the Millennium Highway, construct a new bridge in Anslery, and rehabilitate the West Coast Road. This consultancy that we're about to sign on this morning is not a typical road design consultancy, at least I can say from my perspective. It has requirements such as road safety, which would normally be taken into consideration by the engineers in their designs. But this one, if I can use mainstreaming, it mainstreams and does make a requirement that road safety has and must be included in the designs.
In addition to the total reconstruction of the Millennium Highway, the West Coast roads from Cul-de-Sac all the way to Soufre will be refurbished. The project will also see the construction of a new ancillary bridge.
Upgrading of the corridor is expected to significantly contribute to economic development through improving access for the agricultural and tourism sectors and improving efficiency in the north-south movement of goods and services to the country's ports. The corridor could provide a vital alternative climate resilient and adaptation link between the Hiranuera International Airport and the capital city, Castries. An improved corridor would provide road users with upgraded access to the most picturesque views and geological features such as the Soufre volcano, coastlines, the Pitons and Sulphur Springs, botanical gardens and indigenous cuisine. The corridor consists of combinations of low-lying, steep cuts, and fairly steep gradients that are prone to flooding, landslides, and scouring exacerbated by climate change.
A consulting firm with expertise in road engineering, traffic management, hydrology, geotechnical, climate change risk and vulnerability assessment, and disaster risk management was awarded the contract through a bidding process. The project involves repavement of the road, installation of sidewalks, drainage improvement, and the cleaning of existing drains.
This project is another opportunity for our engineers to utilize their training and experience gained working on several regional projects over the years. We are aware and sensitized towards issues of the informal economic sector, mobility challenges, gender disparity, and climate change, among others. Our design proposal will incorporate both adaptation and mitigation strategies to minimize the adverse or unwanted impacts. We also note that most of the route has limited or no provisions for pedestrians and non-motorized traffic.
The works are still in the preliminary stages and are expected to be completed in the next 2.5 years. The project was made possible with grant funding from the Caribbean Development Bank, CDB, and the United Kingdom Caribbean Infrastructure Partnership Fund, UKCIF. The signing ceremony took place at the Department of Infrastructure. For the DBS News World, I am Sheffield Gillard.
Opposition St. Lucia Labour Party spokesman Dr. Ernest Hilaire has accused the government of distorting tourism arrival figures. The Castries South MP says while the tourism authorities boast of a 2.2% increase in visitor arrivals for 2018, most of that figure came from cruise arrivals and the yachting subsector, while stayover arrivals have actually been on the decline. Here is Don Nicholas with that story.
SLP spokesman Dr. Ernest Hiller pointed to the statistics which indicate that the 2.2% increase in visitor arrivals were largely due to an unusually high increase in March 2018. For the other 9 months of the year, stayover arrivals decreased when compared to the same period for 2017. The Soleil Summer Festival, he says, has not achieved its purpose to boost tourism. Instead, a number of festivals held during that period on which thousands of dollars were spent saw a decline in visitor arrivals, like the Roots and Soul Festival.
Roots and Soul Festival, September 2018, a decline of 6.5%. Arts and Heritage Festival, October 2018, a decline of 7.1%. CPL and Mercury Beach were held in August 2017. 768 more people came to St. Lucia. Or 3.3% increase.
The other events, like the Food and Rum and Jazz Festivals, showed minimal increases. Food and Rum showed a 3.5% increase, and in the case of the Jazz, only 84 more persons came in 2018, in contrast to the year before.
St. Lucia Jazz Festival, May 2018. 841 more persons came into St. Lucia over 2017, a 2.7% increase. St. Lucia Carnival, July 2018, there was a decline of visitor arrivals to St. Lucia.
Dr. Hiller also noted that St. Lucia's visitor arrivals increase of 2.2% was well below the Caribbean, which stood at over 6%. For the DBS News World, I'm Don Nicholas.
The mobility of St. Lucians with physical disabilities is expected to be improved after the humanitarian arm of the Church of Jesus Christ of the Latter-day Saints donated wheelchair and other mobility devices to the Ministry of Health and the National Council of and for Persons with Disabilities. More from Fennell Neptune.
The National Council of and for Persons with Disabilities welcome the generous contribution of wheelchairs and mobility devices from the Latter-day Saints charity, which will bring much comfort to the disabled. A key component of the visit was the training of persons as assessors and technicians on how to assess a person's mobility needs, as well as how to assemble and use the wheelchairs. President of the Council, Mafalas James, says, he is pleased that St. Lucians are now trained to serve patients with mobility challenges around the island.
So as a result of this training, we now have a proud team of 6 local assessors and technicians who are fully trained to execute this program, who are now able to go out into the communities to do these assessments, to do it in an efficient, convenient, and customer-centered manner. When I say customer, I do not mean paid customer. I mean client. I mean the people we serve, the people we work for, because these are donations. They've been given to us freely, and we will give them freely.
Minister for Health and Wellness, Senator the Honorable Mary Isaac, expressed appreciation to the Latter-day Saints charity for the generous contribution and says it will make the lives of the disabled easier.
So I am saying to you, St. Lucia, this gift that we have received, I want you to take care of it, to appreciate it, because it was given to you with so much love by people who do not even know you, people who took time off their busy schedules to travel all the way down here to give you this precious gift.
Caribbean wheelchair specialist for the Latter-day Saints charity, Don Hart, says his organization remains committed to making a contribution that will allow the disabled to enjoy a life of mobility. The Latter-day Saints charity donated 138 wheelchairs and 101 mobility devices. Reporting from the Communications Unit of the Ministry of Health and Wellness, I am Fennell Neptune.
And now this. A motion of no confidence brought by the SLP against Prime Minister Alan Shaste will be debated in the House of Assembly on January 29th. This is the date given to the leader of the parliamentary opposition, Philip J. Pierre, by the Speaker of the House. Mr. Pierre is calling on all St. Lucians to follow the debate very closely.
According to Leader of the Opposition, Philip J. Pierre, the motion was ridiculed by the government and has been dismissed by many others who think it is doomed to fail. Nonetheless, the Leader of the Opposition says the Speaker of the House of Parliament has set January 29th as the date for the no confidence motion to be debated.
Then the Prime Minister and his PR people suddenly start announcing the start of projects which were stalled for the last 2.5 years. But if only designs and plans, but no processes to ensure accountability and transparency. But none of these has stopped the momentum of the no confidence motion.
The motion cited a number of areas where the opposition has expressed dissatisfaction with the Prime Minister's management of the country. In light of this, the opposition leader is calling on St. Lucians to take a keen interest in the debate.
St. Lucians, both home and abroad, are taking a keen interest in the upcoming debates. They're anxious to see if any minister would vote with their conscience and register their vote against the policies of the Prime Minister.
Mr. Pierre made the comments at an SLP conference on Wednesday. For the DBS News World, I'm Don Nicholas.
Following a series of incidents involving minibus drivers of Route 1A, President of the National Council on Public Transportation, NCOPT, Godfrey Ferdinand, is urging commuters to do what is necessary and within the ambits of the law to ensure that drivers guilty of misconduct are held accountable.
1 week after a grizzly bus driver allegedly threatened to drive his passengers into the sea, a father claims he was asked to pay adult fare for his six-year-old daughter. The driver in question then asked all the passengers to get off the bus when the father refused to pay adult price for the child. President of the NCOPT, Mr. Godfrey Ferdinand, says he is aware of the situation but did not want to comment on the matter as it is being investigated. He is, however, disappointed. It is the bad experiences that are being highlighted.
We are good talkers. We can talk about every other issue. And when it's time to act, we don't act. And it's in every sector in St. Lucia where people just talk. And sometimes when you do good, the good is never mentioned. It's always a negative. I can tell you on an average, the bus driver receives several threats and verbal abuse and so forth. We don't necessarily report it, but on an average now, we have commuters reporting what they deem to be injustice or unfriendly customer relation.
While Ferdinand says there is no shortage of recommendations to improve the sector, the enforcement of any implemented measures is what's missing. As a result, both the commuters and operators take matters into their own hands.
There is a standard, my bro. There's a standard. One is if a commuter feel that they have been unjustly dealt with on the route, they can file a report, especially when it comes to fares. They can literally go straight to the police officer and have that person arrested if there is proof. Okay? So they can make that, they can take that approach. They can also go and write a letter to the association, CC a copy to the National Council, as well as one to the Ministry of Transport, and the matter will be investigated. And then the commuter would be called into a meeting, as well as the driver. Normally that's not done.
The NCOPT president noted that most times before a situation can be properly investigated, or a formal complaint made, incidents are being reported or published on social media. For the DBS News World, I am Sheffield Gillard.
Still in the first segment of the broadcast, Street Vibes.
Hello everyone, I'm Don Nicholas and this is Street Vibes. Today the question is, what can be done to help people who are suicidal?
for me, when I hear about somebody being suicidal, I think you need to find the resources the island has available to get some form of counseling, because it's very important. You have to know where your mind is at, what can trigger another attempt, you know. And we must be reliable on our family, our peers, and we have to check on each other. It's very important, because sometimes I think our mind has a snap button, and the time that happens, there's probably nobody around, you know. So we have to look out for each other, you know. And there are signs, you know. Sometimes people give you signs. You look at phone messages, you look at status messages, Facebook messages, you know. Social media is very, very available, and we just have to be aware and just be there for each other, especially when it comes to family. Family is key.
Well, I think it have a lot to do with the person's mentality. Some of us, I cannot say for sure we can do something to help somebody who is suicidal, because we never know. We never know who is suicidal. We never. Sometimes people go through stress and they don't speak to anybody about it. They keep all their problems to themselves. They're different individuals. Some who have a best friend that would share something with them, and sometimes the person would not even know they are suicidal. Sometimes these things happen overnight. A problem may strike, and you understand, different individual, different thinking. So I am not sure what can be done to help people that are suicidal. I just know the most important thing is to pray. Is that we pray and put God first in everything, so, and we take it from there.
I think those persons are looking for persons they can trust, even with the wrong choice, hoping that you can hold it, you can keep it. All right, but you, as the person listening to this person plight, you need to use wisdom in dealing with that situation. You need to, even if you think of talking to somebody, but you have to be very tactful in doing it, because if that person just doesn't want to lose their trust in you. Anything that you do will just trigger them, and it will push them towards suicidal, being more suicidal.
First of all, you can provide 40 counselors, 1,000 doctors. The first help must come from within the person. The person must decide that they want to live. You follow me? If they don't reach that stage yet, then nothing can be done. But if they're willing to live, then you have to speak to them. The person obviously has lost something of core value to them. Why are you suicidal? Because you lost something which is valuable to you, and you think like life is not worth it. You follow me? You have to bring them back to know what life really is. It's not what you material things or people around you have lost, but you have hope from inside your spiritual well-being. You follow me? And if you connect to the Most High God, there's always hope. Once you have life, there's hope. So don't give them feel like you're the last person in the world or you're the only one who's going through it. There are people who have gone through depression, you follow me, and suicidal thoughts, and they're alive today because what? It comes starting with a decision that you can make it. Another thing too, worry about what people see, what people think of us, and it brings you down. But after all, you have to realize that if you die in the cemetery, 1,000 people go to the funeral, but nobody stays with you. At the end, they block off the talk and know that you deserve to live, and life, there's a new start, there's a new beginning. Tomorrow could be a new beginning for you.